For sure we are blessed with that wonderful message and song. And that's the reason why we decided this morning to be in the house of the Lord. Because we know that we need the Lord in our life.
Amen.
Well, nice to be back after a year. That was 2012 of 2013.
13.
And we are privileged to be back. In fact, last Wednesday we had a wonderful time talking about our plan for 2030. The fruit of the Spirit. Talk about the fruit of the Spirit as well. Some of you are familiar with the song, The Greatest Love of All, by Whitney Houston. The saying is, the greatest love of all is easy to learn. And it's easy to achieve, for the greatest love of all is what? It's to love yourself. Isn't it, that's the song? This loves, a lot of people love to sing that song. I remember our eldest daughter, when she was, I think, 3 years old, while we were still in the Philippines, started singing that song. And we are so amazed to hear the voice. Although the words is different from what we heard from. But the song has very wonderful impact in her life. But the point is to love yourself. The greatest love of all, when we talk about it, is the same. What Jesus said, I have loved you. Based on the Gospel of John, chapter 13. The word love. It's very big words, strongest word. To the point that if you ask your shipmate your shipmate beside you, or someone beside in front of you, find a different response. I know we are in a multicultural church. We have different definition of love. Try to ask your shipmate, what does love mean to you? And we have also multi-generational as a church. Because the word has a different meaning for different people. Would you like to try that one? Try to ask someone beside you right now, what does love mean to you? I'll give you time. Ask them, what does love mean?
What does love mean to you?
You'll see different definition.
What?
Husband and wife will reach for something. And the children, what is that? There was an interview done to some ladies and some girls. Okay. Because love has so many different meanings. And there was some interview to some young girls, ladies, and old women too. For them to know about what is love. Love for a 5-year-old girl, he said, love for her is when he takes my chocolates and comes back with its wrapper. That's a 5-year-old girl. 10-year-old daughter, 15-year-old girl said, love is when we caught banking and he takes the blame. Look at that. 25-year-old lady, listen to this one, is when he proposes with me, with a rose, and make fool of himself and says, you know how much I love you. You remember that? And after 10 years of getting married, love is said when he cleans the house, singing with that. Sounds familiar? Now, after 15 years, a 50-year-old woman said, love is when he is ill and still cracks a joke, just make me laugh. And after another 10 years, 60-year-old woman said, love is when he's taking his last breath and saying,
I love you.
I'm glad I know you that love is and lives with a tear forever. See? Love has a different meaning to different people, for different generation. And it has a different definition in a different culture. For they say, love is a supreme feeling. Let's talk about what does Apostle Paul when he defines love. Elijah lived to us in responsibility, right? 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And we talk about agape love. And when we talk about agape love, it's a different love compared to filial love or eros love. And that is what Jesus said to us today. A new command I give to you. Love one another as I love you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you what? You love one another. I tried to do a study on that and look at the original word. I thought it had something to do with filial love because the relationship between men and women, or men and men, or parents and children. But this definition of Apostle John from the statement of Jesus goes back with the statement of love defines in 1 Corinthians chapter 30, the agape love. Does it mean to say that Jesus tells us something more deeper understanding of the word love when he told us, I love you as I have, that you love one another. That you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Again, this is easier said than done. If we are what? Not connected, we are not abiding with him. Oftentimes, you only love those who are lovely. But what about those who are lovable? It's hard to love them, right? Because you want to do it in our own way. But when we are connected with Jesus, he loves us, no matter what. That's the word that God to love. The selfless love. The self-sacrificing love. As we look on 1 Corinthians chapter 13, another definition is the unconditional love. Oftentimes we say, I love you because I love you, because you're good. But if you're not good, do we still say that then? But the unconditional love is what Jesus tells us. So Jesus showed to us the word love. By demonstrating love, he is loving his group in spite of their shortcomings and failures. Because Jesus said to his disciples and to all of us followers of him, that you love one another so that the world will know that you are my disciples. Now, the word love is not only true words, it needs to be action, and Jesus showed to them by loving his inner circle, the 12 disciples. How many of you agree that they're all lovable person? Isn't it that they are what? Not having a good relationship? One of them would like to be the best among one who will sit the left or the right hand of Jesus. But find out shortcomings, John, a beloved, whom Jesus, the disciple whom he described himself, whom Jesus loved. And let's focus on Apostle John. John, did you know that had a bad temper and a short fuse? One example. Jesus and his disciples together with John were doing the ministry. But people were not receptive to the ministry. You know what John said and his brother? Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? It's found in the Bible, Luke chapter 9, verse 54. But I don't know if that's the right description. Yes, it's in the Bible. Open it. John chapter 9, verse 54. But let me ask you, is that what Elijah did? Did he ask fire from heaven that they may consume them? I don't think so, because Elijah prayed for fire to come down and consume the sacrifice, not the people. You see the attitude of John? Because people were not receptive to what they're doing, he would like to request God, oh Lord, help us to have fire come down, consume them, because they were not receptive to what we're doing. But the experience of Elijah was that what? To consume the people. But what? Consume the sacrifice. Because Jesus said to him, you did not know what manner of spirit you are. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save men. See the attitude of John? And how many of us have that kind of attitude? There was a couple celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary. How many of you have been to that one? Let me see your hand.
Yeah. Oh, no, not 50. I'm sorry.
Well, because, tell me, we'd like to give you the presidential greeting from the White House. Uh-huh. That's what I usually do with our family, even back in Orlando, connect with our congressman, and White House will give you celebration. But aside from that, there is a couple who is celebrating their wedding anniversary. And the daughter asked the mother, and here's the question. She said, Mom, what's the key to the happiness and joy that you have known through the years? And listen to what the mom says. He said, you know, I made a list of 10 things I would overlook about his personality. Things I didn't like. I made promise that when those things come up, I would overlook it for the sake of marital harmony. So the granddaughter said, Granny, tell me more about the list. You make that list, and it comes together. She said, I never write down. But every time your grandfather would do something, make me hoping mad, I would think, lucky for him, it's one of those 10 things. Isn't it a description of a wife loving the husband in spite of his shortcomings? Another experience here is Jesus loves us in spite of our failures, and the life of the disciples, Peter, the man who always speaks ahead of what we're supposed to do. He's the leader of the group. But his worst failure happened on the night when Jesus was betrayed. Look on the Gospel of Matthew 26. If you look, let's open your Bible. You will find out that this was an experience when the disciples were Peter, but say, Lord, I didn't know you. But it is interesting for us to know, mm-hmm. when these things happen. Are you looking at Matthew chapter 26, verses 69-75? It said, Peter denies Jesus and whips Peter. That's the worst failure. But the question is, how come, or why didn't Peter end his life in despair like Judas? Remember, it's not only Peter and Judas, the other disciples, but Peter himself betrayed Jesus. But the question is, why didn't Peter end his life in despair like Judas? Apparently, he caught a glimpse of the unconditional love of Jesus. Several pages tells us something. I want you to read together. Would you like to join with me reading? It said, since the death of Christ, Peter has been bowed down with remorse. His shameful denial of the Lord and the Savior's look of love and anguish were before him. Of all the disciples, he had suffered most bitterly. When he said, I didn't know him. You know how many times he denied Jesus? Then Jesus had a glimpse. That glimpse brought Peter back because he knows that Jesus loves him in spite of his failures. How many of you remember this song? Tie a yellow ribbon round the old oak tree. Is that your favorite song? He says, why is it became a number one hit for many years? You know, there are some stories, but one of the stories I know was a prisoner, an ex-prisoner, was given a pardon, get out from the prison. Send a letter to his dear wife. He said, I'm coming home. And I would like to know if I will find a one yellow ribbon, the old tree, then I'm ready from home. In other words, you're willing to accept me for what I have done. So that day, this man was so excited when he's riding on the bus. He said, remember, the song Forget About Us, if he didn't see any yellow ribbon. While they were driving, riding on the bus, he told the bus driver, please slow down. I'm looking for something. He's looking for what? A yellow ribbon around the old oak tree. Now let me ask you, did he find one yellow ribbon?
Many, I think.
Did he find one? Two? So three? So four? Many. How many? 100 yellow ribbons around the old oak tree. Because he said, if he didn't find any yellow ribbon, he said, forget about us, put a blame on me. But the fact that he was what?
Accepted.
Accepted, in spite of his failures. He went. That's why Jesus loves us. Jesus loves us in spite of our shortcomings and failures. What do you think our world will be for 2013? If we don't know that Jesus loves us in spite of our shortcomings and failures. And if we go check our reality, what in our relationship at home are not same thing with Jesus accepting us in spite of our shortcomings and failures? What do you think will happen? You know, Romans chapter 5, verse 5. I want you to open your Bible. This is something interesting. Because you may say, well, that was Jesus. He loves us in spite of our failures and shortcomings. But what about me? There are some people that doesn't love me. Oh, I don't love some people. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. I want you to focus on that one. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. See, love is a gift. Have you ever forced someone to love you? What would be your reaction? What? Hate or pain or pain. The point Apostle Paul is trying to tell us here, the gift of love could be given to us by the Holy Spirit if we want Him to be given to us. You saw Aliana share the gift of love. Open your room. You know, the Heavenly Father is very much willing to give the gift of love for us to learn to love those people in spite of their shortcomings, in spite of their failures. Because I believe if we don't understand what is love, it will be hard for us to love God. Remember the scripture reading? In 1 John 4:8, my first Bible text when I was growing up, God is love. But the context said, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And the scripture, as we read this morning also, how could you say I love God, whom I haven't seen? How could I say, I don't love my brother? The Bible tells us, I am what?
I'm a liar.
A liar! That's why the only thing we could learn to love people in spite of the shortcomings and failures is when we ask the Lord what? Fill us with that love. You know, did you know what happens when we give permission to God to fill our heart with that unconditional love by His Spirit? It's more than winning $1 million. You know why? Because we will experience joy. As we start this year, 2013, the fruit of the Holy Spirit is not something automatic. It is a process. That's why there is an abiding. And it would not be easy for us to love even the unlovable if we don't have the love of Jesus in our hearts. Because our attitude is to break even. She doesn't love me. I don't love her anymore. But Jesus